So, yeah, this is a paper in progress on information and mobilization and demand for redistribution in South Africa, and is joined with Patrizio Piraino as well, who is there, and Eva Beckner. So Eva and me, we are in Hamburg, but also affiliated to Saldro at UCT. We were in Saldro previously, and Patrizio is still there. So this research started when we were all there, essentially. Okay, so I want to spend a second on the motivation, because I think it's important to bring you on board. So I first want to do some general motivation about why focus on redistribution and demand for redistribution, and then a more specific motivation of our paper. So for the general importance of redistribution, I think we heard in the keynote speaker talks, like talk about redistribution and how it matters for inequality, right? For Brazil, for example, and then other people also talked about redistribution. And I mean, you might know better than me, but from what I recall of the top income papers at the beginning, they were making a big point about how taxation was important for keeping the reductions in inequality for a long time in France and in other OECD countries, right? So redistribution, I would say, it's fair to say it matters like in a clear way in the short run, but it can also matter like for explaining like broad differences, big differences in inequality. So what then determines redistribution? I think maybe dominant view for a long time was that actually inequality would be one of the key determinants of redistribution. And it was in such a way that, so from this Meltzer and Richards type of idea that when inequality is very high, the median voter is poor relative to the mean, and then he will or she will demand loss of redistribution. Okay? So in some sense, the story was a reassuring type of story, so that in the end, like inequality from this political economy point of view is a bit self-regulating. So when you get like lots of inequality, then the median voter becomes very poor and then demands more redistribution, and then inequality decreases. But in already, I don't know, 10 or more, 15 years, like this story about the effect of inequality on redistribution has been put into question like severely. So I would say that now, I would say the consensus now is that we don't really know. But certainly we don't find in the data a strong relation between inequality and redistribution in the way said in the theory. And so this applies both in a cross-section. So it's not the case that more unequal countries tend to redistribute more, and also over time. It's not that we observe that as inequality increases, we see consequent increases in redistribution, right? And this is relevant internationally, and also is relevant for South Africa, right? Because South Africa is a country with, as now we all know, so huge levels of inequality, but the levels of redistribution are not so big, are average. So then, what then determines redistribution, right? So there's one specific paper of quite some relevance by Kutsiemko and others, Emmanuel Saez is also there, that looks at the role of information for demand for redistribution. Okay? So basically what people demand, whether the policy preferences for redistribution, for taxation. And so this paper takes a sort of, I think, a relatively natural step in asking, can it be that then one of the reasons maybe why redistribution doesn't react to changes in inequality maybe is because people are not so aware of the degrees, the levels of inequality or where they are in the income distribution, or they have wrong information. Okay. So they did a survey experiment, which is also what we did, and I will explain shortly a bit what it is. And basically what they find is a bit puzzling in some respect, which is that providing this type of information, so this is for the US, affects the concern for inequality. So people that are treated, given all this information about inequality and what happened to inequality in the US and stuff, they report to be more concerned about inequality. But then when asked about policy preferences, about their desired taxation, they are not very much affected. So it seems that you give information and then people get concerned, but this doesn't follow, so the policy preferences don't follow. Demand for redistribution doesn't follow from this concern. So it would appear that there's some missing element between being concerned and wanting to change things, right? And this is where our paper enters, right? So our argument, I mean, in some sense, is very intuitive, and in other sense, is hard to pin down in a very precise way. So we're still working on the sort of precise theoretical argument. I'm going to give you here more the intuitive part. But I mean, it's a very straightforward argument that it comes from social movement theory, like these sociologists were talking about this in the 80s, arguing something that is useful for the puzzle that I just mentioned, which is that grievances are not enough for making people go to action, right? So people may perceive lots of injustice, but that's not enough for make them do something about it, right? And the missing element in there, that literature, is mobilization. So you need some sort of social force that tells you, so yes, things are unfair, and this is not okay, but we're here, it can be changed, we're going to do something about it, and it's possible to change. Okay, and so you need someone that mobilizes people in order to really then affect this, this idea. And I think that also this argument is also relevant for South Africa, because in South Africa we've seen in the last 10, 15 years a very strong discourse at the leadership from the ANC and other parties on jobs. Jobs, jobs, jobs is really, I think it's fair to say, it's kind of a big part of the social discourse in South Africa. And then to the detriment of inequality and redistribution. So it shows up, inequality and redistribution does show up from time to time, but it's not so much dominant. So in some sense, what we are saying is that the arrival of a party like the Malema party, which is a very redistributive, I mean, it's a party with a very clear redistributive policy, should affect what people say about redistribution. That's, in some sense, what's it. If Malema is credible, which is something I will come back to later. Okay, so this is the basic idea. And then what we do exactly is we conduct a survey experiment in two Cape Town townships. So what's a survey experiment? It's just a normal survey where then you provide some treatments to some people and not to others in a random way, right? In order to assess the effect of these treatments on some stuff you are going to ask them about. So in all, we have now, like, we have around 1,600 observations. So the big bunch is in Khayelitsha, so it's a black, African black township, and apart some 400, 500 in Delft, in the colored section of Delft. So we have two different townships. I will talk about that later. And the treatments that we give are information on local inequality, trying to replicate the findings of the paper I just mentioned, this Kuchenko and Scythe and others. And then we give two other treatments, that are supposed to generate this idea of mobilization. Okay, we'll talk about this now. And then of outcomes, we have, like, we ask them about this concern for inequality and about policy preferences. And then we have, like, one outcome that it could be very interesting, but we haven't looked at it yet. So I'm not going to present the results for this, but it's like we ask people then, if they feel strongly about this redistributive policy, whether they could send an SMS to the local councillor or sign a petition to try to operationalize better this idea of an action. But I'm not going to present yet. We don't have yet this thing figured out. And one thing that is very relevant that we still have, we're going to do a second wave of this. So, I mean, we have scope for adding things. So the feedback would be really, really great. Okay, so let me talk very quickly about the two places. So the two townships are Khayelitsha and Delft, as I said. And, Here I have some demographic characteristics and here some outcomes. So Delft would be the colored township and Khayelitsha is the African black township. So essentially, Khayelitsha is poorer. There are less people that work, and matric levels are relatively similar. But then informal housing, there's like half of the houses in Khayelitsha are shacks, essentially, informal settlements. Whereas in Delft, they're all former housers. And then, yeah, so the Khayelitsha votes ANC and Delft votes DA, overwhelmingly. So the local councillors are ANC for Khayelitsha and DA for Delft. So they differ significantly. But it's interesting to give already a feel of the outcomes, relevant outcomes in the two townships. So most of the people think that inequality is a problem in South Africa, right? 90%. Then we try to capture this idea of whether we have managed to shock this idea of mobilization by asking people about whether they think that high inequality is inevitable, right? And you see that around half think that high inequality is inevitable. And then we ask about preferences for taxes. So would you want to increase the top tax? So we ask it in a sort of very slow way so that people understand what we mean, but this is essentially what this is. And then very few people would like to increase the top tax rate, right? And this basic income grant, where there has been some debate in South Africa about it. And there are more people, maybe because they've heard of it more, there are more people supporting it. And then we also asked whether people would like to have some extra tax for whites, which was something that Desmond Tutu at some point raised. And we see that it varies a lot by township. So I just want to put one thing that I find interesting and already reviews our argument, which is that you see that the poorer township, they tend to think more often that inequality is inevitable, and they tend to demand less often an increase in tax rates, right? And the same for this basic income grant. And the only big difference is really this tax for the whites, which is something that you would expect because the coloreds are generally less supportive of this type of things. So, I mean, this obviously doesn't prove anything, but I mean, it sort of illustrates our argument. Okay, so let me show you then what are our treatments. So we have essentially three treatments. One is to give information about local inequality. So from the census, we computed income levels and also levels of ownership of certain assets, like fridges and computers and so on. And then we show them here in different neighborhoods of Cape Town that are also very recognizable for everyone living there, like Newlands, Camps Bay, and here we have Guguletu, Philippi, and then we had some colored also, Athlone and Michel's Plain, I think. Okay, so we give this type of information. This is the local information. In the international information, we basically from the World Bank, so from the World Bank, we took some measures of the ratio of the share of the 20% to the top 20 to the bottom 20%. I think it was that. And then for some countries, some important countries like the US and some countries that are around them. And so we did it in a way that we wanted to make them pay attention to it. We were first showing them this graph without South Africa and asking them to guess what the data says about South Africa. And then afterwards we will show them the thing. So, I mean, this is supposed to capture the idea that the high inequality in South Africa is a bit of an anomaly. That was what we wanted to generate, right, with data that is real. Obviously, we selected these countries, so we didn't put Namibia, which also has very high inequality, okay? But meaning the idea, which is, I think, a fair thing to say, is that South Africa has unusually high inequality and that inequality does not have to be so high and is not so high generally, okay? That was the thing we wanted to communicate. And then we have video messages. We were giving on top of these two information treatments. And we had three videos. One from Suma, one from Malema, and one from Tutu. And the three videos were condemning inequality and saying that something should be done about it. Right? And it was very easy to find the Malema video. It was we found the Tutu video, and it was hard to find the Suma video. So this really points at the thing that it's not so easy to find like ANC discourses that are explicitly right now about inequality. Okay. So we wanted a bit of a cross-section of the type of messages that people, the type of elites people get exposed to. Okay. So the results. Let me go directly to the results. So this partly is nice, partly is a bit maybe strange, or maybe not strange, but unexpected. Maybe we should have known better, but this is what happened. So here I have essentially different outcomes in different columns, and here we have our treatments. The local information, international information, and this is the video on top of the local and the video on top of the international. So first, the effect on this concern for inequality, whether inequality is a problem, right? So to start with, as I told you before, the levels on average are relatively high already. So it's hard to shock it, right? But still, it does. So you give the local information and people, so there's some effect that then people tend to think more often that inequality is a concern, right? And you give the international information and also, because people then, it has, makes them think a little bit that inequality is a problem. Now, the sort of nice thing is that we replicate the results from this paper I referred to about the effect of local information, right? So it affects the concern for inequality, but we ask them about top taxes or this basic income grant, it has no effect whatsoever. So this is as they find. And the nice thing is that when we give them now this information about international inequality, it does shock strongly the perceptions of inevitability of inequality and a consequent change in preferences for taxation as well as for this basic income grant. Okay? So this is nice, and this is the thing that it fits with what we thought. Now, in reality, our mobilization, the videos were supposed to shock people to think like, yeah, we can change inequality, right? And make them think that it's not inevitable, right? And it has the opposite effect. So it's something like, we were shocked. We thought that maybe in some townships, you know, we thought that maybe in Delft, it wouldn't be clear, but we thought in Khayelitsha it would work. But no, it's really like you give them the videos on top of the international treatment and it totally, well, not totally, but a big chunk of it gets undone. So they see the international evidence, they see like, yeah, it's possible to decrease inequality. And then they see their elite guys talking about that and say like, no, it's not possible to reduce inequality. So, but then what is sort of interesting, and this we have to think what it implies, is that then following this, they also then reduce their demand for tax. And this is something like that I think that precisely is what I was saying, that we need to think precisely what is the channel that would generate this thing. It looks kind of nice because it looks a consistent pattern where changes in perceptions of inevitability lead to changes in tax preferences, both for the top tax and for this big. Although this here is not significant, but it's essentially similar story. And then the last thing is that, so all this stuff doesn't seem to have to do with this racial stuff. So it's not that it affects any perceptions on these taxes on whites. So I just want to say one more thing and then conclude. So one thing that is relevant and I really wanted to point out is that these results are really robust, these two things. So here we break down by township and you observe the same pattern. So here's inequality inevitable and these top tax preferences for Khayelitsha and for Delft. And okay, for Delft we have like few observations and the results are sometimes not significant, but the pattern is there, very clear, and for Kailich as well. And also another thing that is partly reassuring and partly concerning is that if you also break down by leader video, so Zuma, Malema, and Tutu, the results are there, even for Tutu, right? So it's really, I think it's sort of interesting. There is something there. I think that. Okay, so let me just conclude. So we sort of give further evidence of this idea that if you give information on inequality, it makes people concerned, but it doesn't lead people to action. And we find, and I put it here in a sort of mild way, so we do find that our mobilization treatments affect inevitability perception and in turn tax preferences. But we have a strong caveat now about this video treatment, that it does the opposite of what we thought it should do. And so our first idea was that the leaders in South Africa just have, like, no credibility. Right? So in the end, they see these people, and instead of getting mobilized, they get demobilized. There's a bit of an issue with Tutu, because we now did some, to try to understand a bit better what's going on, we did some focus groups, showing them the video and asking them to tell us how they felt about the video. And it's clear that people like Tutu. In both townships, they like him, they put that. And they saw the video and they were mostly happy about it. But there was a substantial chunk of people that felt sort of sad about it. So it just felt like it's concerned. He talks about inequality and like how there are these people that don't have anything and these other people that have a lot, and that some people reported feeling depressed and sad about it, right? So there's something whether... And it was the same with Zuma. Zuma, many people didn't like him, and Malema also many people didn't like him, but for Zuma also some people were reporting feeling this, having more this, like, yeah, depressed type of feeling. And few people felt angry, which in some sense is what I was expecting more, that people would just be angry by seeing these people talk about inequality like that. No, doesn't seem to be the case, more like depressed. So, yes, as I said, then we have a second survey round. I think what would be really nice is to really find some really credible leader that really would then get us what we want, right? Really generate people to think that inequality can be changed. So we have to then think a little bit like local leaders or even sports stars, or this is sort of a bit the direction we are thinking. Yeah? Okay, thank you. That was it.